Romance of the Three Kingdoms is one of the four great classic novels of China. It tells the tale of the chaotic period at the fall of the Han Dynasty, and how different group of warlords were assisted by their brave warriors and cunning strategists to establish their own kingdoms of Wei, Wu, and Su. This is a tremendously popular narrative in East and Southeast Asia. If you have ever consumed any media from the East, then most likely you have come across an adaptation of it in one form or another. Like the hack and slash Dynasty Warrior series, for example. Recently, even the British company Creative Assembly also cashed in on this insatiable thirst for all things Three Kingdoms and released their own game. So, what is it that makes Romance of the Three Kingdoms so special? If you compare it to other world literature, the Iranian epic poem Shahnameh was the product of the great poet Ferdowsi. Mahabharata was traditionally attributed to the great sage Vyasa. Romance of the Three Kingdoms, on the other hand, was the product of nameless commoners and low-level bureaucrats. Seriously? Plebs and paper pushers? What sort of a story could these nobodies create anyway? Well, let's find out. For the benefit of those unfamiliar with the story, let me give you a brief synopsis. Romance of the Three Kingdoms is a historical fiction based on real historical events leading up to the establishment of the Three Kingdoms. Nobody did a proper statistical study, but it is traditionally considered to be 7 parts truth and 3 parts fiction. The main discrepancies are mostly about who was where in which battle, and to who some of the victories were credited to. But of course, the devil is in the details. The narrative is centered around the fates and fortunes of 3 major warlord factions, which would eventually establish the Three Kingdoms. The cunning and meritocratic Cao Cao, who swore that he would rather betray the world than let it betray him. The righteous and benevolent loser, Liu Bei, who claimed descent from the imperial Han lineage. He kept losing for the first half until he met his strategist, Zhuge Liang. The Sun family, who claimed descent from Sun Zi, the author of the military manual, The Art of War, whose patriarch, Sun Jin, discovered the imperial seal, the symbol for the mandate of heaven. But this story is not just focused on the leaders. The bulk of it is spent on their followers, like the fiery Zhang Fei, God of War Guan Yu, Lu Xun, Sima Yi, and even the villains and foils, such as Dong Zuo and Lü Bu, the mightiest warrior in the Three Kingdoms, whose battle prowess was unfortunately not matched by his intelligence. The novel mostly covers the events near the fall of the Han Dynasty and the early years of the Three Kingdoms. Then it sped through the middle and the end of the period, because most of the interesting heroes have died by then. In the end, all the Three Kingdoms also fell and was taken over by a completely new dynasty, the Jin Dynasty. I will do a more thorough summary in the next episode, but for now, the outline should be enough. Now, let's talk about the evolution of this narrative. It is interesting to note that in the folk stories, Liu Bei was considered to be the legitimate ruler of China. But in the official history, it was Cao Cao's kingdom of Wei which was considered to be the legitimate China. It is easy to imagine Wei as the legitimate one, since it controls the most land. But the real reason is mostly because the writer of the History of the Three Kingdoms, Chen Shou, was commissioned by Jin Dynasty to write the history, and the Jin Dynasty derived their legitimacy by usurping Wei. So they needed a direct line of legitimacy. As you can see, there is some kind of narrative tug of war here between the officials and the common folks. The Romance of the Three Kingdoms is the combination of the two, but still heavily favors Liu Bei. But the truth is, this shift towards Liu Bei happened in both domains. Chen Shou's text was supplemented by another historian, Pei Songzi. The essence was mostly unchanged. The way it was categorized, however, saw evolution through time. The history book, Records of the Three Kingdoms, were originally 3 separate books. The Book of Wei, Book of Wu, and Book of Su. In the history book, Old Book of Tang which was written before the Song Dynasty, only categorized the Book of Wei as part of the standard history, and the other books were just biographies of people of interest. But in the revised version, which was written in the early period of Song Dynasty, all three were considered to be part of official history. When the second emperor of Tang Dynasty, Tang Taizong, was compared to Cao Cao, he considered it a compliment. But if you call someone Cao Cao after the Song Dynasty, then it would be considered an insult. Because by then, the image of Cao Cao had turned into a treacherous villain. So, what the heck happened during the Song Dynasty? Well, the Jurchen-ruled Jing Dynasty happened. It conquered the northern part of the Song Dynasty, and the two dynasties made competing claim for legitimacy. And this is where they began to shift the legitimacy away from the amount of land occupied to bloodline and confucian virtue. This shift was further exacerbated by the fact that the Jing emperors also paid homage to Cao Cao. So during this period, both the official histories and folk stories shifted to the glorification of Liu Bei. Later on, the Mongols came around and conquered all of China and established the Yuan Dynasty. During this period, there was a major development in Chinese opera, and many plays based on the Three Kingdoms and added to the wealth of the narratives. It was also in this era that one of the first collections of folk stories on the Three Kingdoms was published, Records of the Three Kingdoms in Plain Language. This version had more fantastical and supernatural themes, and Liu Bei's faction was the clear protagonist in this one. It was in Luo Guanzhong's novel that we started to see a bit more balance. His book combined the elements of folk stories and historical text. It was originally called San Guo Zi Tong Su Yan Yi, or Common Stories of the Records of the Three Kingdoms. It was published in 1522 in the Ming Dynasty. But Luo Guanzhong actually lived during the second half of Yuan Dynasty and the start of the Ming Dynasty. So there is still a bit of a controversy whether he was the real writer of the book. Nevertheless, we can now see how the political musings of bureaucrats and the common folks coalesce into an epic drama. Liu Bei was benevolent and righteous, but Cao Cao wasn't without merit too. The latter was ambitious, power-hungry, but he promoted talented men and executed corrupt officials. He brought peace within his domain, yet wanted to conquer more. Is righteousness worth anything if you don't have the power to uphold it? Luo Guanzhong lived most of his life under the Yuan Dynasty Mongol rule. During that period, southern Chinese were placed in the lowest position of the caste system. But it didn't mean that life was always bad. Even the Yuan Dynasty had its mini golden ages. As the decades of long war against the Mongol ended, they were able to rebuild. Kublai Khan's successor even promoted Confucianism. But of course, they eventually messed up. The Wu faction is often forgotten or treated as treacherous as they keep switching their alliances between Wei and Su. But they actually represent a very important Confucian dilemma. And that is the conflict between loyalty to one's country and filial piety. You can debate about righteousness and legitimacy all day, but at the end of the day, if any of the other two kingdoms triumphs, then they will come after the Sun family. Now, do you consider that the fate of the empire to be more important than your own family? The common folks, however, are more likely to attach themselves to the smaller heroes of the three kingdoms, mainly those from the Liu Bei's faction. Early in his life, Liu Bei was an impoverished straw sandal weaver, and Zhang Fei was a butcher. So they can see a reflection of themselves in these figures. They even went on to inject themselves into other characters. There are no historical records of Guan Yu being a tofu seller, but he was imagined to be a tofu salesman in the folktales. Zhuge Liang, Liu Bei's advisor with unparalleled intelligence, was often insulted by his enemies as country bumpkin or only worth as much as three cobblers. These additional narratives put them squarely in the common folks' camp. Even Luo Guanzhong got into the action. Lu Xun was a young and intelligent bookworm from Wu who did not have much military experience. Yet, it was his plot that led to the capture and execution of the god of war, Guan Yu. His strategies also defeated Liu Bei's mass punitive army. In the previous book, he was mostly ignored, but in Luo Guanzhong's novel, he was given the spotlight for a few chapters. So it seems like Luo Guanzhong saw a bit of himself in this young scholar. In a way, the Three Kingdoms narrative is really like a massive collection of crowdsourced fanfiction. That is why readers can usually identify with at least one of the many featured characters. Now, I want to talk about the literary value of Romance of the Three Kingdoms. But before that, I will expose a major twist in the development of this novel. San Guo Yan Yi, the Romance of the Three Kingdoms novel you have read in Chinese and those translated into English, is not Luo Guanzhong's version. The book that we have today is a heavily edited version of Luo Guanzhong's book. During the Qing Dynasty, the father and son duo Mao Lun and Mao Zonggang did a major rewrite of this book. The title was shortened to San Guo Zi Yan Yi. This is actually the version that we have today. We just dropped the character in the middle. They improved the narrative flow, but also cut down the number of words from 900,000 to 750,000. They added and deleted some scenes, and even reduced lines praising Cao Cao's officers from 34 to only 6. The famous opening and closing line, "The empire long divided must unite, long united must divide," was also their addition. This line did not exist in Luo Guanzhong's version. Some of you out there might be thinking, "What? So I've been reading a lie?" No, just because this is not the original version, it doesn't mean that it is bad. Far from it, actually. This is a brilliant piece of work with multiple layers of depth. Even though it is based on historical events, you can see the growth of each characters. Zhang Fei, Liu Bei's rash and hot-headed general, learned to use strategies later in his career. Cao Cao, plagued by his poor reputation, worked very hard to redeem his image. Even the benevolent Liu Bei turned into a bloodthirsty invader to avenge the death of his sworn brother, Guan Yu. The overall tone of the novel also changes as you read it, like it is growing up together with you. There is a lot of influence from street-side storytelling here, as evidenced by the hook at the end of each chapter. It usually ends with questions like, "So what will happen next?" All will be revealed. Different parts of the story would appeal to audiences of different ages. In the early chapters, battles were won by heroism and martial prowess. These are the themes that appeal to younger audiences. In the middle of the novel, clever strategies and tricks won the day. As you get older, you need to learn how to work smart. Then, from strategies, it shifted its focus to the appointment of the right officers. As you matured, you would gain more responsibility as a manager of a company, or when you became a parent, you need to learn how to delegate your work. Finally, at the end of the book, when the successor of the original heroes allowed the kingdom to crumble, you are experiencing the same sense of helplessness as you watch your children ruin your legacy. That is why, if you read Romance of the Three Kingdoms at different stages of your life, you will get a fresh take on it. You might even identify with different characters you previously ignored. I have read this online comments a while ago, which I think is really profound, but I couldn't find it anymore, so I'm going to paraphrase it. "When I was young, I wanted to be like Zhao Yun or Guan Yu because they are strong and heroic. When I got older, I want to be smart and successful, like Cao Cao or Zhuge Liang. Then, when I had my own family, I understand Sun Quan's predicament and his shifting alliances. Now that I got older and I'm starting my own business, I found new respect for Liu Bei, who never gave up despite failing for half his life." By the way, let me remind you that by the time Liu Bei met Zhuge Liang, he was already over 45 years old, and he had the humility to listen to the advice of a man almost half his age. So he finally established his own kingdom in the end. For all the flaws of these Three Kingdoms characters, they are heroes in their own way. It might be hard to get all this on your first read through, especially when you are young and you expect to get all the hack and slash action from the beginning all the way to the end. most people would stop reading after the death of Zhuge Liang, the last central character. In fact, a popular modern Japanese translation of Romance of the Three Kingdoms by Eiji Yoshikawa also ended the main story after the death of this loyal prime minister. Chapter 105. The translation is actually complete all the way to chapter 120, but everything from chapter 106 to chapter 120 was dumped into the epilogue section. Obviously, this is done to cater to the taste of modern readers. And I have to admit that the last stretch is grueling. It is very heartbreaking to read how the kingdoms your heroes built get destroyed by their incompetent successors and conquered by the seemingly unrelated Jing Dynasty. But I say it is very important to read it all the way to the last bit, because you can really get the essence of the writer's message by knowing how the story was concluded. The plain language version was all about karmic justice. The main story also ended with the death of Zhuge Liang. Then it skips to how the Jing Dynasty was later demolished by a descendant of the Han Imperial line, Liu Yuan, to round off the narrative of karmic justice. What the book didn't mention, however, was that he was actually a Xiongnu warlord who invaded China during the uprising of the Five Barbarians period. Furthermore, in real history, he did not even eliminate the Jing Dynasty. It actually survived for another 100 years. He was even a descendant of Modu Sanyu and was the product of the marriage alliance between the Xiongnu and Han Dynasty. So technically, he did have some Han Imperial blood. But it is still quite a stretch, eh? Romance of the Three Kingdoms, on the other hand, had 15 more chapters after the death of Zhuge Liang. 15 chapters of painful decline, ending with the similar line it started with. The empire long united must divide. Long divided must unite. Each of the three kingdoms can be seen as a microcosm of a Chinese dynasty. Whatever ideals it was built upon, it may still have its flaws. Cao Cao's Wei, built upon cunning and meritocracy, was usurped by Sima Yi, a smarter man who schemed from the shadows. Liu Bei's Su, built upon righteousness and loyalty, became ineffective due to their blind loyalty to an incompetent successor. The Sun family's familial bond led to the selection of a spoiled and sadistic king. So, what does this all mean? Everything will fail? No, I don't think that the message is so nihilistic. I think it is trying to say that while it is easy to think that your enemy is wrong, maybe you should have the humility to consider that you might not have the right answer either. There would be other dynasties, other people who came after you who thought that they have the answer. But they might also be wrong. Nevertheless, everyone who fought for the ideals they believe in are all heroes in their own way. If you ask me what is Romance of the Three Kingdoms, then I would say it is the product of the uncertainties, dreams, fears, and aspirations of the little people who are thrust into a divided world where we are forced to pick a side. If this video got you interested in the Three Kingdoms, then go read it, or watch any adaptation that interests you. The 2010 series is really good. Don't worry about authenticity. The Three Kingdoms narrative is a living narrative that gets constantly updated anyway. It has become some sort of canvas for people to explore related ideas. In fact, it would be interesting to know if one day you can come up with your own version. If you are new here, then let me introduce myself. My name is CJ, and on this channel, we cover the history and culture of East Asia and the rest of the world. Subscribe if you want to get more contents like this. And if you appreciate what we do here, then come to Patreon and be our bro. Until next time, stay cool, my bros.